In today's episode, we will test open source digital FPV using hardware from RunCam, specifically the WiFiLink 2. We checked how it works, how it performs in terms of reliability and range at this moment, and we will evaluate what the future development of this platform may look like. The most popular digital FPV systems today, mainly DJI and Walksnail by Cadex, already work very well. From time to time, we get new hardware and firmware updates, but these are still completely closed systems, impossible to expand or modify and to create your own hardware or software for their ecosystem. The early days of FPV were of course analog. It has always been simple and open. Anyone could build a transmitter and a receiver, which resulted in a wide variety of hardware on the market, low prices and many user modifications and improvements. However, range and image quality were limited. For a long time, this was acceptable because there were no alternatives available on the hobby market. For several years now, we have had digital FPV, which brought a significant improvement in image quality, and over time the range also became large and the link stable. It's no surprise that with the availability of this technology today, the community also creating open source projects. Just like a few years earlier, Express LRS was created, which now offers an excellent RC link, with transmitters and receivers available from many different manufacturers. Today's hardware is the RunCam WiFiLink 2, which of course consists of a receiver and a VTX with a camera. It can run OpenAPC, which is a system for operating, managing and streaming from various IP cameras, including FPV cameras like this, as well as Ruby FPV, a system based on a similar concept but designed specifically for FPV use. Developers have been working with this for several years already, expanding and optimizing their custom setups and achieving very good results. Here is an example where almost 23 km of range was achieved on a custom build setup made from various hardware components, even before the release of WiFiLink. WiFiLink, however, is hardware that is much more accessible to the average consumer. It's basically ready almost straight out of the box. It doesn't require manual assembly of modules, soldering, printing cases and so on. It's a step toward providing an easily accessible and inexpensive FPV system for the average user, with potential for expansion and further development. So let's see how it looks in practice. There's nothing surprising about the receiver. It resembles receivers we already know from the market. We have a USB-C port, which can be used for example for flashing firmware, OTG for copying recorded videos, a microSD card slot, as well as UART and I2C, which can be used in the future to expand the ground station. The video output is via mini HDMI. The cable included in the set has mini HDMI on the output side and standard HDMI on the other side. You can connect it wherever you want, for example to a monitor, goggles or a computer. However, this is also a point where additional latency is introduced, which may vary depending on the display device you use. The set also includes a power cable with an XT60 connector ready to be connected directly to a battery. The stock antennas include two LHCP antennas and two with vertical polarization. We will test how they perform later, but in any case we will eventually use different antennas for better performance. As for VTX, it looks quite solid. We have heatsinks as well as a fan, which can be removed to make the board thinner. The connection to the flight controller uses a standard connector like the ones used for DJI or Walksnail present on many models FCs, so no soldering is required at all. For clarity, the connector is 6-pin and includes all wires, but not all of them are used. Yellow and the one of the black wires are responsible for DJI RC link communication in drones using DJI RC and DJI Air units. Here we have the full cable and it can be left unchanged. Two wires will simply not perform any function. The input voltage range is from 9 to 22 volts. The standard connection via the plug provides 9 volts or sometimes 12 volts. You just need to remember that if you power it directly from the battery or from VBAT on the FC, this cannot be done with a 6S battery. You must use a reduced voltage. There is also an RJ45 port, which may seem strange, but in this case it's normal, because this is actually a small system-on-a-chip computer running Linux, not a microcontroller like in other systems. Via RJ45, you can connect directly to the terminal of this computer and perform configuration, manual parameter changes, firmware updates and so on. For a normal user, this will not be necessary. Firmware and basic parameters can be flashed and changed via microSD card. RJ45 is native for this computer, it's stable and doesn't require drivers, which is why there is no USB port and simple PC connection yet. USB supports multiply connection modes, requires drivers, and creates more problems for firmware developers. This also shows that this is still a development platform that is becoming more user-friendly, but is not yet a mass-market product. The camera is in a standard 19x19mm size and supports 1080p and 90fps, and 720p and 120fps, which are quite good parameters. Let's also see how it can be mounted in the nose of the aircraft. As an example, we used the stork from our collection, where we prepared two nose variants, one for walk snail and one for WiFiLink. The VTX is mounted without any issues using foam double-sided tape. It can also be mounted using the standard 25x25mm mounting pattern, which is more typical for multi-rotor frames. From the factory, the hardware comes with one of the Ruby FPV versions pre-installed, but the first thing to do is update it to the latest version. On the RunCam website, there is an instruction on how to do this and where to download the firmware. It's done quickly by copying it to the microSD card and going through the short sequence of steps, after which the firmware installs automatically. Here we already have the latest version at the moment, 11.6 installed. After connecting everything, it just works and configures itself automatically with default settings. The system found the nearby transmitter and using the joystick on the VRX, we can enter a clear interface and browse the available options. Among the more important things in the general information section, we have the board type set to RunCam 2, and it's worth making sure this is set correctly. The radio link automatically selected the optimal channel, and the maximum power for this transmitter is about 300 milliwatts. The OSD also appeared automatically. The layout was previously configured according to my preferences in Autopilot, which we are using. And the OSD type in this case is MSP OSD. The system detects it on its own and no changes are needed. Individual settings, it's worth checking whether the link mode is set to bidirectional video link. This is the default option and it works the same way as in DJI or WalkSnail. The VTX sends video and the receiver sends acknowledgements and feedback about received packets. If a packet is lost, it's retransmitted. In addition, various information about signal quality is sent. Thanks to this, the transmitter actively reacts. It can adjust image quality, bitrate and so on. As a result, we get better penetration and range, because packets can be retransmitted and the whole system actively fights to maintain the video link. However, this behavior affects latency, which can change dynamically depending on conditions and link quality. The second option, which is simply one-way broadcast transmission, like in analog systems, works in such a way that the transmitter only sends the signal and there is no feedback from the receiver. In this case, we get worse penetration and shorter range, but constant and lower latency. It's good that we have this choice. For freestyle flying with multirotors at short distances, it may sometimes be better to choose one-way broadcast. We have covered more or less everything needed for the first flight. We did several tests, starting with stock antennas and flying at close range. The video output was connected using the HDMI cable from the set to a monitor. What is immediately noticeable is quite high latency. The image was not very smooth and appeared rather choppy. Even at close range, there were short image interruptions and the overall flight experience was not very comfortable. We completely lost the signal at just under 300 meters. Which clearly shows the limitations of the stock antennas. On the following day, we repeated the test using a different antenna setup. A pair of TrueRC X2 Mark II antennas and two 120mm OCP antennas, all with LHCP polarization. The test didn't start perfectly. Immediately after takeoff, the image was choppy, but it stabilized fairly quickly. The overall experience with this antenna setup was significantly better, even though occasional video dropouts were still present. The link proved to be highly sensitive to environmental conditions, interference from other transmitters and electronic devices, as well as antenna orientation and directionality. In some areas, the link quality was better, while in others, it degraded much faster. Ultimately, this configuration allowed us to reach approximately 1800 meters before losing the link and initiating the RTL. This is a substantial improvement compared to the stock antennas, but it still doesn't offer the level of comfort and reliability expected from the daily used FPV system. There is no doubt that the results could be improved further by testing in a cleaner RF environment, experimenting with different directional antennas, or actively tracking the aircraft with them. With the current RunCam hardware, slightly better performance is certainly possible. However, at this stage, it's still not a product that can realistically compete with mainstream systems such as DJI or Voxnail for regular users. That said, the directional development is the right one. Over time, we can expect better hardware and significant performance improvements, even on the same platform by future firmware updates. For now, this system can be recommended to users who enjoy experimenting, testing new technologies, and fine-tuning settings. But it's not yet the platform you can rely on as your primary everyday FPV system. I support the ongoing development of Ruby FPV as well as the efforts of RunCam and other hardware manufacturers in pushing the FPV ecosystem toward greater diversity and steadily improving performance.